Welcome, everybody, at the first live event for the Cannes VTS. We are very honored to have you here. And first of all, some housekeeping before I start doing all the introductions. So just to assure you, this is completely according to the rules that our Dutch government implemented on Friday. Unfortunately, it does mean that tonight you have early bedtime, so you'll be fresh tomorrow for the Mets again. But this is all according to the RIVM rules. We do ask you to remain seated. We will ask you later to try out the VR, but one at a time, and then the rest can remain seated. So thank you, Mets, for allowing to use the room. They are sponsoring this conference room today. And who is Cannes VTS? The Cannes VTS is the Dutch Royal Society of Maritime Engineers, and we are very young, since 1898. And this society has about 2,000 members in the Netherlands, and has the goal to stimulate innovation in the maritime industry, to spread technological information under their members. And as you hear, we're doing that in English, because today a lot of our members are English speaking, or at least Dutch is not their first language. So, who am I? I'm Ruben Wansink, and I am the event manager of the Cannes VTS in Amsterdam. And we have four locations. The headquarters of the Cannes VTS is in Rotterdam. We have one in the Zeeland, in Vlissingen, and also in the north of the Netherlands. And very often they are close to nautical education institutions. And we are very happy to do this live. We usually do webinars, and as I said, we like to spread technical information. And today we have a very interesting subject. And the subject today is how to design a icebreaker with virtual reality. And who hasn't dreamt of visiting Antarctica? Has anybody been to Antarctica here? Yes, we have one amongst us, and that's going to be our first speaker. And that is Finn Wollesen. He is the managing director of Knudi Hansen, and he's been to the South Pole a few times. And I've actually heard the penguins still talk about him. He worked on the design of the RSV Nugena, and that is the icebreaker that we are discussing today. This icebreaker, very sophisticated, complex ship, was designed and built for the Australian government, and they are using it now to supply their Antarctica bases to do research both on the South Pole and in the oceans around it. So Finn sailed the one of the first, I'd say, icebreakers they were using for the Australian government was owned by the company called J. Lauritsen, and called the Nela Dan. You will see it on his t-shirt when he comes up soon. Finn lived in Spain, Singapore, and Italy, and you can guess they still talk about him. So he founded the company Marine Technologies, and in 2003 that merged with well-renowned Danish naval architect Knudi Hansen. And our second speaker is going to be Mark de Wolf. And Mark de Wolf is going to be explaining how the ship was built. He's here for Damen Naval. And Mark de Wolf worked 7 years on this project from the whole, from the design all the way up to the tender phase. He has a background in mechanical engineering and is a naval architect, and he is the verification, validation, and acceptance manager. And you can guess that was a tough job on this rather complex ship. Another housekeeping, to allow you to try the VR, which we will allow you, some of you, to test the virtual reality, what we'll do is we'll bring the speakers on. First, Finn and Christine will explain how the virtual reality works and how they worked on this ship. Then Mark will explain how it was built. And then after that, we will do all the questions. And while we are doing the questions, we will allow you to try out the virtual reality. So thank you. And Finn and Christine, the floor is yours.
Yeah, so Christine will do all the interesting stuff and I will do all the bullshitting. A good design always starts with a story. And this one is a very long one. It started during the Second World War and it's actually a movie today, Our Man in America. He refused to follow the Danish government, so he allowed the Americans to establish bases in Greenland and use these to fly over and Greenland tank, go to Scotland, and from Scotland bomb the Nazi Germany. And after the war, we had to develop Greenland further, and we needed icebreakers. And that was started up by the company J. Lauritsen, and also that has transferred into some public. There's a book written about when this all ended with the sinking of the Neladan in 87. This book is released in Denmark, Australia, UK, United States, and Czech Republic, and Germany. And it's a very interesting book. And that was the start of, for us also, of the Nuina, because I found out that the Aurora, which replaced the Neladan, would have to be replaced more or less 30 years after 87. So I started hunting that project in 2007, had meetings with AAD in 2009, and then the consortium of, we are part of Darwin, consortium of Darwin, DMS, and Knud Hansen won the design and build of the Nuina in 2014, I think it was, Mark. Sorry? Yeah, we started working in 14, close, yeah, that's right. So, the Neladan, yeah.
Well, it's a story about penguins itself, but I went on board Neladan meeting. I met there Finn, and we have been friends since. But you can get the story later about the penguins. It's quite fun.
Yeah. Quickly on Knud Hansen. It's a naval architect company established in Denmark 1937 with offices around the world, 9 offices on different continents, a staff of around 100, mainly with technical background. We always tease Maersk that we are the only Danish company working on all 7 continents because they are not in Antarctica, and we are for the Australians and for the Americans. Clients, the usual suspects, ship owners, and today I should probably highlight the Dutch ones, Van Oort, Damen, Fedship, where we have work for right now. Enough from us, so back to ship space. Christine.
Yep. Ship space. Have you ever wanted to be in your own design and see the concept firsthand or grasp an arrangement through to scale? That is what ship space is about. It allows you to export the 3D CAD models into the virtual world, viewed from a first-person perspective and incorporated into your design. So welcome to ship space, the virtual reality tool. This software is developed by, you go too fast, Finn. Yeah, I'm not finished with the bridge. Yeah, stay there. Well, this software is developed by Robert Spencer in Perth, Australia. And why ship space? Because complex structure are very complicated, and design mistakes are very often found until after construction they have been seen or even been completed. There's a very short story about a Danish hospital in 21 floor. They built it in 1970, 21 floors. When they were going to move in all the equipment, they found out all doors for the hotel rooms were too narrow. They couldn't get any bed in. And even the doors to the toilet, they couldn't get in the wheelchairs. I mean, it's a hospital. So it cost the state 2,000 million euros to do that rework on that hospital. So that was a disaster. Maybe that could have been avoided if they had included the staff or the interest of the work. Yeah, let's have another one. Yeah, so ShipSpace is about a it is a collaboration platform. What's different from this software is that it's not a 300-degree guided or pre-recorded tour. It's a tour on your own, like you will be there yourself, like one-to-one experience. I'm not that tall, but it. Okay. Let's have another one. Yeah. So, what makes ShipSpace unique, and why does it make it so real? And that's the amount of polygons. So, ShipSpace creates images instantly by 1.4 billion per second, and that means polygons. The more polygons, the more clear the picture quality, the depth and vision will be. So in the car industry, like they saw, they use 80 million. And as you can see here, just a little take out from those, but 1.4 makes it quite clear. And you will see that when you get into ShipSpace. Yeah. One of the other things about ShipSpace is the very important tools we have. So if you are on a paper or you are on site for real, you have a lot of tools in your palette you can use. That you can do in ShipSpace as well. You have a measurement. Let's say the nurse or the porter at the hospital, they can do then, if they had the VR tool at that moment, they could have done a measurement in the room. They could see that the door was too narrow. They take a picture of the measurement they have done, and that picture goes directly to the designer. And in 15 minutes, you have the change in the design. And that's quite important for building because of the costly rework. And the poster you can add in to see if in maintenance, can the technical get behind the engine or the pump or whatever. Layers is that you can, in an installation room, you want to see only how is the pipes running here. You can take away all the layers, only have the pipes in the air. And the magic board can move you up and down so you can inspect the pipes from wherever you want. The X-ray, if you have something installed in your walls, let's say CVC, central vacuum cleaning, you can actually, with the X-ray tool, you can see where the pipes are running for that system. Yeah, so that's the importance of the tools in the design.
On the tools, you can add, if Mark and I have been discussing a day, here's a penetration in one room, and then he says, Finn, this is ridiculous where you have made the cut. And then I can say, yeah, but Mark, yesterday, look at the X-ray. You wanted the cable trays in the room beside to run exactly this height. You cannot get both. But we can discuss it before, at least before it's built. So you'll see examples on this.
This is a little drawing about all the benefits of using VR. it includes all the interest in a design. So for instance, staff involvement, now we have again the hospital, but actually also Nuina, we involved the captain on the bridge to check out if everything was, the working positions, stations was probably placed and that he could have the view around him. There's nothing, crane or anything was interfering with the view. And I will get back to that. But maintenance, design, engineering, construction, this is just the platform really for what the benefit for VR is. This I will show you in just 1 minute, but this is the story. I have the captain story and Finn will talk about the driver and the cook. Real stories from this. But here we have the captain, just to make, I will get back to it, but now you see the drawing, he is actually doing the measurement in VR. So we get to the, this is a muted video, and I will, just this. This is our partner in Australia. But as I said, the captain went on 1 hour at the bridge to check out his workstation. Everything was probably placed for him. It can be quite annoying if the one who's wearing the headset is moving his head too much around. But here he is teleporting himself to the workstation. And now he goes to the side wing. There is a workstation, and the wing, the window wing you see in the floor in the deck, he is inspecting. This is from the real story. This window was placed wrong. It needs to be moved. I can't remember how much it was, but 10 or 15 centimeters. So when he work on a station, he need to be able just to bend left to see if he can see seaside of the ship, along the seaside, through the window. But that window was not properly placed, so he went with the measurement, took a picture, it need to be moved 15 centimeters towards me. He took a picture and it went to the designer and was changed in 15 minutes. This story was so real for the captain, so he went to his own seat. He actually sat himself down. Nothing hurt, he didn't hurt himself, but it was so real for him. So this is from a real story in the design, yeah.
When Ken nearly killed a client. We have demanding clients, and one of the cruise liners we were doing design for, he said, I have always complaints from the staff that they're not involved in the decisions. So he wanted the cook to approve the layout of the galley in a big cruise vessel. So he gave him a 2D drawing, and the poor cook was nearly crying because he has never read a 2D drawing. So what we did, we modeled his workspace and put him in it, and he was standing there, and then he started complaining, Knud Hansen, if you place the stove here, I will not have any knees when I'm 40 because I have to step every 3 seconds to get my tools. We have to move it. But the oven you can place in the other end because I only look at it once every hour. Doesn't matter. So he could actually, because of this, add some value to the design. Another demanding client we have is a big Italian ro-ro operator. And he's a very clever man, so he also said, my truck drivers always complains about your pillars down in the garage with their trucks. They have to approve that they can drive around with my trucks. Same story, they cannot read a drawing, so they were also sitting there. Then we modeled a truck, we modeled the garage, and we put them to drive in virtual reality, and they, in the end, they actually approved it. So you can really use it to involve the staff.
I can take the just quickly, but in the offshore business, when you're the concept know your ship. Today, I don't know exactly, but I've heard that you actually sit in front of a drawing or pictures of your ship or the platform, which you need to know in purpose of security. Here, actually, you can be trained in VR. You can walk around all the levels the security ways, and so if the alarm goes, you know exactly where to go. So in the offshore business, in training, it's very good as well.
Yeah, and then the digital twin and the Apollo syndrome. We have not created a full digital twin yet, but for the Nuena, we are working with AAD, at least to be able to support them on certain things like helicopter landing and train them before they actually fly on the Antarctica. But the end product should be that you could, from anywhere ashore, let's say it was the Nuena, you could support from Hobart with experienced staff if they have problems in Antarctica where nobody can come and help them overnight. So you could be in the engine room virtually, and then the guy who's on Nuena, he's getting guidance from a guy who sees actually the same thing, but virtually. And that's also mine. That's good for ship owners and shipyards, because you can save money. When you build any ship, but especially cruise vessels, you make a lot of mock-ups, and for example of cabins. And if you did the first couple of them in virtual reality, and you could get the architect to come in, and all the curtains is are red, and the ship owner, he hates red because his wife prefers green, then you can go to lunch, remodel it, and get him back in the cabin, and you build the final mock-up real only. So that's money. We discussed that a little bit earlier, so I'll not jump too much on that. That was where we could, shipyard and owners also often discuss where should the door be placed. Certain rooms, like HVAC rooms, you can never win. I remember on the Grand Princess Richard Y, he told me, Finn, you are in a losing game. If I get a bad service area in the HVAC room, I will complain. And if I get a good one, I will ask, why did I not get another cabin? But here we can, in virtual reality, probably agree with yard and owner where we should put the limit before we actually build it and not have the complaints afterwards.
Every dollar saved in design phase is $10 saved in construction. That actually says itself. Let's take the other picture, Finn.
Yep.
Yeah. What we have seen by using ShipSpace is that it's very useful in conferencing through Teams. So, during Corona, we have actually used this very much and find out that a lot of traveling actually can be avoided. Not all, but quite a lot, because you can go into the space. You can be in Denmark for the designer. You can have the shipyard, or in Australia. So you can see actually how many you want and be in the same space at the same time and discuss the design. So can't avoid all traveling, but quite a lot. So it has a little stamp on the environment as well. Yeah. Penguin. Yeah. So for whom who can't try the ShipSpace today, I can do a demo through Teams. It's just to notice my mail address and make an arrangement with me, and I will. We can do a Teams meeting, and you will be able to see and try through the virtual through Teams, of course. So, yeah.
Yeah, we're not completely finished. We have another movie coming here, but as Christine said, you can grab a business card and. There are movies available that we can mail to you, demos, or you can call in and have one in Denmark. Well, I'm such a bad engineer that I had to become a director, and that's why I don't know much about this. But when you're talking about ice, if all this doesn't work, just go back to the old-fashioned story with Arne Sørensen on Antarctica. So use the old technologies. The last movie before we hand over to Mark is the one we always end with, and that will test your capability within your prayers, because you can, in the moon pool on Uina, try to be Jesus and walk on water. 9 out of 10 cannot do it, because it's so real. Some of you might have a try in a couple of minutes' time, but else we'll hand over to Mark now, I guess, to get the real story.
Thank you. Thank you, Finn. Thank you, Christine.
So first of all, thank you for inviting us to tell our story on the Nogina project. As already introduced by Ruben, I'm Mark De Wolf. I'm involved in this project from the early start in 2014 for us, a bit later than for our colleagues from Knudi Hansen. In the proposal phase, as the proposal engineer responsible for the technical solution and the technical negotiations with the client throughout engineering, production and commissioning till delivery last August, when the vessel was finally accepted and handed over to the client. I try to make it a short story. It's a big project with a lot to tell about, I run quickly through the project background, the ship itself, and then our engineering phase, production and commissioning. First the project itself, it's already a little bit explained by Finn and also a little bit by Ruben. The ship is basically three types in one. It's an icebreaker, it's a resupply or cargo ship, and a scientific research ship. That all together brings a lot of facilities which need to be on board. Let's see. Basically the forward part is related to cargo resupply, to resupply the Australian stations in Antarctica. We have a lot of fuel to bring there, two big cargo holds which can hold approximately 100 containers. Then, basically we have a lot of sensors in the bottom to do research in the water and even sub-bottom profilers. And we have a lot of sensors in the top of the ship to do atmospheric research, a big weather radar, for example, but also special air sampling systems to sample clean air, not adjusted by ship outlets and stuff like that. There are drop keels provided to lower sensors through the boundary layer, so not to influence the performance of the sensors, but also sensors which are not provided with special ice windows were placed in here, because everything which is placed in the hull needed to be protected against the ice again as well, of course. Then the machinery spaces in the usual areas. So we have splitted engine rooms, two, one forward, one aft, and then two electric propulsion rooms. This whole deck, marked in yellow over here, is basically the science deck, we call it. So there you have operational areas, laboratories, everything basically to have a look on what's being measured or sampled and post-process everything. And then on the aft there is a big so-called science working deck where all kind of scientific research materials can be put into the water by means of A-frames and overhead cranes. On top of that there is a big helicopter helicopter deck with a helicopter hangar in front, which can handle up to 4 helicopters. Helicopters here on this ship are often used for resupply also to the stations, or bringing people up and down, or if they can't get close enough to the stations to just do the last bit with the helicopters. Then of course we have a lot of accommodation also. The vessel can sail with 150 people. 30 of them are crew, and the rest is all scientists which are working on board or brought to the Antarctic stations. Yeah, and as every ship, we also have a wheelhouse. We just already saw it in the movie of Finn. But to keep the wheelhouse a little bit quiet, there is also underneath the wheelhouse there basically a second kind of wheelhouse where all the scientists can go and have a look outside and sit and relax. That's I think in rough lines the ship. Of course, we also need some big cranes forward and aft to put all the supplies we bring to Antarctica onto the ice to transport to the stations, or to put on the barges we have on board. So a lot of things are brought together in this ship. Looking a little bit more at the technical part of it. See if that works. Yeah. So first of all, as I already told, the vessel has splitted engine rooms. Basically, that was also chosen as this vessel is operating in very remote areas, to be able to if something happens, you still have one engine room left to get home. So in the main engines of the ship are diesels, just normal diesels, each about 10 megawatts of power, and then on top of that we have two electric motors in it. So it's kind of a hybrid propulsion. The reason why we choose that was because we have to be able to put a lot of power into the water to break some ice. On the other hand, it's also a science platform, so we need to be silent. So we need to have a silent mode in which we only use the electric motors fed by the diesel generators. And then, in the end, we also have the DP condition in which we operate the ship with the six thrusters. Keep it in position, and then the electric motors on the shaft are used as a PTO to feed extra electric power into the net. So that's basically how the propulsion system is designed and why it is like that. As said, the vessel has a DP2 notation, so that means that we have we should be able to handle single failures of big equipment or losing a complete engine room. So that's also one of the reasons of splitting the engine rooms and the electric propulsion rooms. Then a bit more about our engineering. So the ship was designed in 3D. One of the reasons was for that. Well, it's common practice nowadays, of course, but for this ship we went in even more detail because the density of all the spaces with all the systems and tools and the scientific equipment in it was so high that you really need to model everything to make sure everything is placed in the right way and that maintenance spaces are kept and So that was done. We also have our subcontractors working in these 3D models to make sure that everything is aligned and as soon as it comes together in production that we make sure that there are no new new things discovered which we didn't find in the engineering. So then basic engineering was done in our office in Vlissingen. For the detailed engineering, we always make use of our engineers in Romania. That's also where the yard is, where we built our, or we have built this ship at least. So they did it also in the same way. They continued on detailing the ship. So also things like maintenance spaces already told, but also kinematics, like movement of cranes, was quite important here, as we have so many different cranes. This is a picture of the aft science deck, where you see an A-frame and all other stern tender crane with different tasks. But yeah, you might need to make sure that everything can work in the end as it should. So therefore, we decided to model everything. And especially for these kind of things, you also virtual reality is quite a good tool to use to make it even better visible. Then part of the design of the ship was also, of course, a lot of model testing. We did some we did together with our colleagues from Knudi Hansen, and also the German-based model test base in HSVA. There we did all the ice tests, but also here you see some bubble sweep down tests. That's then to determine whether the bow shape is good enough, and that that there are not too much bubbles going underneath the hull where the sensors are located, for example, that it doesn't influence the sensors too much. The design of the propeller: on one end it should be a very strong propeller for the ice breaking operations, but on the other hand it should also be operate very silent in the silent mode. So all these kind of things were done very much detail, and the whole testing campaign was quite big, or even a lot bigger than we normally do. Also for here you see some tests at the Dutch NLR for smoke tests for the helicopter operations, to see if everything, if the helicopters doesn't have problems when landing with the smoke from the funnels. This resulted then again in a redesign, for example, of the funnels. We also did something, in first instance we started with CFD calculations on that, and then that these were then finally proven by the model tests. But also for example the whole propulsion train, we had to do a lot of simulations also especially when ice breaking, you have a lot of forces working on your propeller, and how is that going into the ship, what do you need. For example, here there was a result of that was to add an additional flywheel of 10 tons just to make sure that the propulsion keeps running when a piece of ice is in the propeller. So all these kind of things were part of the early design phase, let's say. Another important thing on these kind of ships, and that's also we also have some experience from our naval ships, of course, is topside design, we call it. So that's the integration of all the different sensors to be put on top of the ship, and to be placed in such a way that they don't interfere with each other, that they can do their job, and also to are accessible in a way that radiation hazards and stuff like that are kept okay. Basically the same is done on the bottom side for all the different sensors. So there we have multi-beam echo sounders, sub-bottom profilers, fishery sensors, almost the complete set of what Kongsberg has in his scope is mounted on the ship, I will say. but also to put everything together and to get all the data, which is that's one of the most important things, of course, for the client to process or first of all measure the data and then post-process it on board and even store it and bring it to the shore without losing any data. A big distribution network is on board with a lot of capacity for post-processing of data gathered. To bring that all together, more than 600 kilometers of cables are installed on the ship. So that gives a bit an idea on a ship of 160 meters and 600 kilometers of cables. That's I would say close or even more than on a Navy vessel. Here this is a picture of the whole data distribution network with all the different storage cabinets. Then, apart from the sensors, we also have laboratories on board, deployment systems to take samples from the seawater. This is the CTD space, for example. But we also have the moon pool, which you saw in the video of Finn. But also a lot of winches with electro-optical cables and things like that are provided. The ship is able to put some troll nets in the water, so also troll winches are there. And then next to the deck, where everything is brought on board, there is straight next to it there is a whole set of laboratories where they can analyze everything, store it, do whatever they want with the samples taken. For example, our special freezers are there to cool the or to freeze it up to. Minus 100 degrees, for example. Special equipment is there. Here you see a picture of the drop keels. There are two of these in the ship. At this moment, only one of them is equipped with sensors. The other one is just in case they want to add additional sensors later on. They have some spare space. That is also one of the things which we're the client was very keen on, is on modularity and they know what they buy now, but the ship has to last for 30 years, and they don't know what research is requiring in 30 years, so they want to be able to adapt. So that's also why they came up with a containerized solutions, and this is a standardized science laboratory container with all different connections. That was then basically made as a dummy, and we had to provide several spots where they can put containers, connect monitoring equipment, but also systems, or for example, there's a system on board for aquarium water recirculation, where they can then connect these containers to. But also on top of the ship, there are meteorological containers can be put on top of the hangar with the same set of connections, so they can easily adapt in future. Yeah, and then on the resupply side, the ship is, as I already said, equipped with several cranes. We also delivered two landing barges with the ship. These were built in Australia, and brought to the Netherlands for testing purposes. These will be used, for example, on one of the stations. They don't have the facilities moor alongside. So one, they use the landing barges to bring the cargo to the shore. The other station, they normally go in the early in the season when there's still ice. So they do the movements over the ice with trucks. And if the weather is really bad, then they can use the helicopters, of course, if they can't get close enough to the stations. But that will, for this ship, I think, not be the case. Then on top of that, several tenders are on the ship. So we have four tenders, and one of them is a science tender. This one is also equipped with several types of sensors. So where the ship can't come in the shallow waters, then they can put on the sign standard in the water and do the job with the sign standards. Production was started in 2017. Engineering started in 2016. Basically we started already a little bit before 2016, but the contract was signed April 2016, and the production started in May 2017. So that's rather quick after the, let's say, contract signing, and then the keel laying was in August 2017. As is normal use in shipbuilding, we put some coins on during the keel laying ceremony. I think Finn, you were there as well. It was a nice party. Yeah. One of the coins is the Dutch silver coin. It's quite special because we choose the silver coin from 1642. So that was the year when the Dutch explorer Abel Tasman explored Tasmania, the home port of Hobart on Tasmania is the home port of the ship, of course. And the other one which is special is the Danish coin, because of involvement of Knut Hansen, of course. But on that coin there is the Crown Prince Frederick and his wife Princess Mary, and she originates from Australia. So that's Hobart, yeah. Yeah, and then we had the Romanian coin dated keel laying date, basically, and an Australian coin, of course. The ship was built in Romania in our yard in Galați. Here you see the ship in the dry dock. That was when the ship was floated out. As the ship is quite heavy for its dimensions and our facilities, the draft of our dock was a bit limited. We had to put a lot of additional buoyancy bags. In total, 700 tons of additional buoyancy was put on mounted on the ship, and moon pools and drop keels were closed off to create extra buoyancy to get it out. And in that state, even the vessel was only half built. So the superstructure was not on yet. Then the vessel was moved out of the dock, laying in front of the dock. All the blocks were put on. Our approach was to have the blocks as far as fitted out as possible. Here you see a block put on, which was already partly in the final paint layer, so everything could be built in inside, and then just put together completely with the coating on it. Here you see a picture of the forward cargo holds during the production. Every now and then we had to turn the vessel because of the crane capacity couldn't reach that far, so we had to turn, and at some point we were even not able anymore to move the crane over the wheelhouse anymore because of the height of the ship. So it was quite on the limit of what we could build over there, but the decision to put it to build it there is that that's a very experienced yard, especially with a lot of experience in offshore vessels and fishery research vessels. So that was mainly the reason. And after that we continued, of course, with completing the interior and starting with the commissioning of all the systems and propulsion, everything. The idea was to completely finish it in Romania, but then COVID hit us, and we decided to at that point in time, the construction or the production was almost finished, and the major part of what needed to happen was the commissioning. And for that commissioning, mainly a lot of Dutch suppliers or Western European suppliers were involved. It was quite hard to get them in Romania at that time due to COVID. So we decided then to order a tug and to tow the ship from Romania via the Mediterranean Sea to the Netherlands. So that was I think that was just decided in early in July 2020, and the vessel arrived in August 2020 in Vlissingen, where we continued with the completing the commissioning, especially all the items which were related to suppliers from these areas. It was still a hurdle to get everyone there, and our aim was to start with sea trials before the end of 2020. That happened also. So we went on sea trials in November 2020. For this, the client had quite a big set of required trials. So basically, we had all the trials we had to do to get our class notation. That was maybe 1 week work, but in the end, we spent 9 weeks at sea in three different sea trial campaigns. So the first one was mainly to approve class that we comply with everything. So performance trials and platform trials, also the DP trials were done then. And that was basically done on the North Sea. We went to Norway to do some underwater noise trials. So within Damen we have our own equipment to install sensors on the seabed and to do noise measurements. But one of the prerequisites of that is to have a silent environment, and that's in the North Sea quite difficult to find with a lot of traffic. So we went to Fjord in Norway, put everything there in place, and spent about a week running up and down the fjord, doing all kind of measurements in different modes of operational modes. Partly to comply or to prove compliance to the client, but also for ourselves to validate our tools and get some knowledge from there, because it's not that often that you can do such a big test campaign yourself. So, and even especially for all the Navy projects, that's quite valuable research you can do. Later on for the client, we also had to do all different kind of deep water trials because they wanted to see their winches, their electric optical cables tested and deployed to 2,500 millimeters depth minimum. So, and in that, they designed special measurement equipment to see if the signal losses were okay, if the slip rings were doing what we proposed them to do. Because for them it's very important that they can do their research with this ship. And that was done in basically two times. 3 weeks in the Gulf of Biscay, where we did these trials, where we found enough depth for that. And then in the end, we were also supposed to go to the Arctic to do the ice trials. But as we ended up summer this year, it was decided together with the client to firstly finish the ship and complete it, that they take it over, and that the ship would be available for their first season starting about now. So in August the vessel was delivered to the client. They sailed the vessel to Australia, and it arrived a couple of weeks ago in its home port. And now they are doing the final commissioning on their side, and they intend to start with the first voyage end of December. And part of that voyage will also then be some ice trials again. I'll try to tell a bit about the ship in a couple of minutes, but there's a lot to tell about the ship and a lot to see. Quite a nice website to look at is the ship's own website. It's here the address is, but you find it easily via Google if you Google on Nuyina. There you see a lot of movies, even time lapse from the build phase. But also the voyages are everything is published there, so that's quite a nice area and a nice site to have a bit more insight on the vessel and its operational life over the next 30 years. So that's my part of it. Thank you for your attention.